Sandeep, can you hear me?
Yes, Subbu, can you hear me?
Yes, loud and clear, thanks.
How many people signed up?
Yeah, we'll just wait for a couple of minutes, Hari. There are people who have logged in.
Okay, great.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Hari, are you online? Can you hear me well?
Yes, Subbu, I can hear you very well.
Wonderful, thank you. So good morning, everyone, for joining in into this webinar. We are very excited to have Hari on board for this very special webinar that we have for us today. Hari, are you also able to see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful, great. So without further ado, let's begin. We have a few people who are logging in as we speak. So we'll get started, do the introductions and get into the discussion. So this webinar will go on for about 45 odd minutes, depending on how we pace it and the number of questions that we face. We have the agenda here, which I'm going to list to begin with. And once again, welcome to everyone who has logged into the webinar from whichever part of the world you're logging in. Hari and I, of course, have logged in from Bangalore. So hello to everybody from Bangalore. I'm going to quickly list the agenda before we get started in terms of what is it that we're planning to cover. Just a couple of agenda items here. One is we will begin with showing you some of the findings of a study that we at KNOLSKAPE very recently finished. This was on aligning learning needs to business requirements. Right? So this was the topic of the study itself, which is also aligned to the topic of the webinar that we have for you today. And of course, very excited to have Hari today. And we hope to learn a lot from him, from his experiences as both an HR leader and a business leader for having run businesses for the first part of his career and then moving on to head HR for different kinds of organizations. Right. So as we go along, I'm sure some of you will have questions. Feel free to type your questions as we go along. So type it in into the chat box or the Q&A section. We will take the questions towards the end of the webinar. Right. So we will do that towards the end. Hari, just a quick sound check. Am I audible? Is my voice clear?
Absolutely, very clear.
Okay, great, thanks. Because I just got a comment saying that there's a bit of an echo, so I thought let me just check. Okay, so great. So let's get started. My privilege to first of all introduce Hari today. Like I said, very special speaker and a close friend also now. So Hari, by way of introduction, he studied at IIT Madras and IIM Calcutta here in India. The first 11 years of his career was spent in various engineering and project management roles. And over the last 17 years, he's been deeply involved on the HR side of things. So he has been part of the management team in several organizations, as you see, both startups as well as scale-ups, as he calls them, including Daksh, Virtusa, Amba Research, Taxi for Sure, which was acquired by Ola, and now at Bigbasket. Right. So that's what his career has looked so far. So as you can see, very rich experience across a whole gamut of both business and HR related activities. He's of course passionate about solving problems and building organizations for scale. So that's his real passion. He works with clear thinking. So for the time that I've known Hari, it's his clarity of thought and his execution. So it's not one or the other. It's both, right? So he's able to think clearly and execute very well in the organizations that he has worked in. He's a mentor to several entrepreneurs in India, and he's already an author of two books with a third one in the pipeline. So last year he published a book called Cut the Crap, along with Shraddha Sharma, the founder of Your Story. And of course, I didn't know that he had published a book some time ago in 2003 called Back to Basics in Management. So that was also news to me as I was researching a little about him for this webinar. So great to have you, Hari. Thank you so much for spending the time with us.
My privilege, Subbu.
Great, wonderful. What we are going to do is that, like I said, before we get started, I'm also going to ask Hari to sort of also set the context here. So Hari, this is my introduction of you. Is there anything else that you might want to add before we get started?
Nothing. This is fairly comprehensive.
Okay, great. Wonderful. Super. So let's get started then. So the two agendas, like I mentioned, the first part is, of course, sharing and setting the context for this webinar and sharing some of the key findings of a study that we very recently concluded here at KNOLSKAPE, what we call bridging the outcome gap. Right. So while organizations invest a lot in learning and learning related activities, businesses, of course, have always been asking for ROI and, what are the outcomes, right? So what is the end outcome of all of these learning interventions that we do in our organizations? So we did a study to find out what's the state of this area of bridging the outcome gap. And I'm going to show the headline items here. So as we go along, I'll also quiz Hari and ask him to also share his rich experiences and insights on how can HR and learning professionals sort of overcome some of these problems that we face on a day-to-day basis, right? So this is the hypothesis by way of context. So we all know that about a decade ago, we had the financial crisis and you know, the need to do more with less was big, and it's still well entrenched in many businesses. So business leaders constantly ask for, you know, a lookout for methods to optimize their resources and maximize value. So given this reality, we at KNOLSKAPE did a poll wherein we spoke to HR and learning leaders across India and APAC. And we covered all of these industries that you see. So close to about 18 to 20 industries that we covered. And we got these responses from about 52 organizations across India and APAC. So that's the sample set. Right? And what I'm going to show, again, just by way of introduction and setting the context, is that is the highlights, right? What are the headline items? What I'm going to show next. So the first piece, the big piece, which is how do you really define your learning strategy and how do you create the training aid analysis and the TNI for your organization? Of course, this I think everybody recognizes, right? So L&D leaders recognize the need to align their learning needs to business requirements. And there's nothing which is out of the ordinary here, which is that 86% of leaders told us that the TNI is, when it is crafted, the inputs of key business stakeholders are taken into consideration. And up to 78% of respondents said that their L&D plan is in line with their firm strategy. But only about 65% of leaders felt that they can change with these external environment changes, the changes that we see, which are outside and not so much inside out. Is it flexible enough? Is their L&D strategy flexible enough to be able to adapt to these changes? So this number, as you can see, is somewhat on the lower side, right? So I'm going to pause here, and I'm going to, I've been talking for a bit now, so I'm going to, of course, ask Hari to pitch in. So Hari, what are your views on the state of L&D today? How do you see it? What do you think works? What do you think does not work?
My view on L&D largely has been, Subbu, that it works best when it is solving business problems. So, you know, I have talked about this in the past, and I will talk about this now, which is that I firmly believe in a 70-20-10 model. And I will just explain that a little bit. Yeah. So 70% of learning, to my mind, happens on the job. It happens, you know, through doing difficult and stretch assignments. It's learned by being thrown into the deep end. 20% of the learning happens by insightful conversations. And those conversations are typically with your manager, because you end up spending a lot of time with your manager. And only 10% of learning happens in classroom sessions. So I'm a firm believer that the 90% must be leveraged very well in an organization. And several organizations make the mistake of focusing on the 10% and doing the 10% reasonably well, but ignoring that 90% and not doing that 90% reasonably well, which is, how do you ensure people learn on the job? How do you ensure that they are thrown into the deep end and provided adequate support at the same time, given opportunities to make mistakes and learn? And also, how do you nurture these insightful conversations? How do you make these conversations a way of life? How do you ensure that every single meeting between individuals is about these insightful, meaningful conversations where work gets done and people also learn? So in my opinion, especially in fast-growing companies, you cannot afford to divorce learning from daily work. You have to necessarily build in learning into work. If learning is something taken away from work and you're expecting people to attend 5-day training programs, it will never work. Maybe in good times, you know, when the businesses are doing well, when they're making a lot of money, when they can afford to take a lot of slack, carry a large number of excess staff, then I think some of this will get done, which is people will get pulled out of classrooms, out of work, and put into classroom training. To my mind, it is neither effective nor sustainable. It can't be sustainable, because when times turn bad, when times, you know, are no longer good, when profits are not easy to come by, this will be the first thing that's cut. So summarizing, I think learning needs to be built into business. Learning needs to be built into daily work, and learning needs to be relevant, which means that people should not see it as discretionary. Those who are paying for this should not believe that they can cut it when things go bad. That's my broad overview, Subbu.
Sure, wonderful. Thanks a lot. So I think you're saying that the starting point and the ending point has to be alignment with business, and there's no two ways about it.
Yes.
Sure. Okay, great. Super. Thanks for that, Hari. So that I think also sets the context for our discussion from your perspective also very well. So let's move on, which is the second part of the study wherein, I think which is precisely some of the points that you mentioned, Hari. So where do leaders stand? So when it comes to leadership buy-in on learning initiatives, we also ask the L&D professionals and HR leaders, where do you think your leaders stand when it comes to leadership buy-in? So only about 56% of respondents felt that the L&D function is viewed as a strategic arm, which is not just a good to have, but very useful to have for the organization. Only 56% of respondents felt that this is true. And just about 65% of leaders who we polled said that, you know, businesses and leaders understand how training delivers these intended business outcomes. So Hari, again, coming back to you, which is that the thought process is there. The, the thinking is might be there, is that L&D might understand that this is important. But when it comes to the how part of it, right? So how do you execute some of this, right? So how do L&D managers, align business requirements to organization learning needs? Typically that 70 and 20 point that you spoke about, the broad 90%, how can that be amplified in an organization from your perspective?
I think it's a great point. So I think let me just build on this a little bit. You know, having said that 70-20 is important, if I don't talk about how do you make the 70-20 happen, then it's of no use. So for let me just give you some specific examples, which, you know, I have personally experienced very intensely. So in my first startup called Daksh, Daksh was a company where we grew extremely rapidly. The product market fit was terrific. And we grew in about 3 to 3.5 years from a headcount of 1,000 people in one city to about 25,000 people spread across the globe. The biggest learning for me was that you can build in learning into work. And the biggest, platform for this was something called the monthly review meeting. So we had multiple functions and multiple business units. So each business unit and each function, the function head and the business unit head had to come in with their team into the monthly review meeting, which was chaired by the CEO and was attended by all the management council members. And each management council member was either a function head or a business unit head. So every MC member had to bring in his or her team for that meeting, present what they did in the last month, and face a lot of brutal questioning, very, very open questioning. And the team had to be, prepared for answers for all these questions. They needed to have a point of view. And if you could go through some of these meetings, if you could go through 12 of these, for example, very successfully, then your CV could be different. You could write a completely different CV in terms of your competencies, some of the competencies that you would have learned, how to be prepared for various questions, how to think through a problem, how to deal with stress when you're asked questions in front of everyone. So all of this you actually learn. These are all, intangible skills that are built in these stressful environments. So I would say that people who went through these for 12 months could write a different CV and were different people altogether in terms of leadership skills. So that was one platform. So recently, for example, the VP product came to me and with a problem, which is that when I discuss with, the users and business functions, they don't seem to be clear on what exactly their requirements are. They don't seem to be able to define the problem correctly, as a result of which my product team ends up spending a lot of time. It's a wasteful activity. So what do we do about this? So I realized, wow, this is a great opportunity. This is a problem that we will address. And I said, I'm not going to talk to you alone. So let me bring in my learning and development head. So we brought in the learning and development head and one of her team member as well. And then we brainstormed this, where I spent a lot of time with the VP product in explaining how do we address these issues through a series of question answers and diagnosis, and then coming to, what's the best way forward. If I had not brought the L&D head and her team member, they would have never known how to deal with such a question from a head of a function. And it's an important question. So one way of building learning is to invite people from your team to the problem solving sessions or reviews or discussions, even when they are not directly needed. So for example, here, neither was the L&D head nor was the team member required. They came in, they participated, they learned how to solve a problem like this. So I would suggest you should invite people from your team into meetings where there is conflict, where decisions are taken, where, you know, collaboration issues are discussed, where complex problems are addressed and solved. Bring them in even if you don't have to, even if they're not really required, because that's a great learning opportunity. You cannot teach conflict in a classroom, how to manage conflict, how to collaborate in a classroom. But in real life, when you're actually dealing with conflict, dealing with collaboration issues, and if somebody is watching and learning, nothing can be more powerful as that. So I would say that these are some of the tools you could use them. It really depends upon, you know, how committed and imaginative you are in terms of, you know, creating learning for your team. If you're committed and if you're imaginative, you can do all this. If you're neither committed nor imaginative, then all you would do is you would send your team member for a classroom session on how to manage conflict or how to collaborate. And to my mind, that's never effective.
Sure, sure. Wonderful. Great. Thanks. Thanks a lot, Hari. So I have noted down, you know, to summarize what you just mentioned, Hari. So one is, of course, having being a part of and being active members of these monthly review meetings or whatever it may be in a particular organization, the group where the critical business decisions are taken. So being a part of that group, and of course, also inviting people proactively, especially L&D team members. And that's something that HR can also do. This is the point that you're making, especially when these crucial decisions are taken. So these problems are solved collaboratively and not in silos.
Yes.
Great. Wonderful. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Hari. That's very, very useful. I'm going to move on to the next set of learnings that we had from our study, which is on these couple of points. So which is, how do you really see employees, see the link to what they're learning to their day-to-day performance, which is their KPIs? And secondly, what sort of capabilities should the L&D team have to be able to solve some of these issues that you articulated just now, Hari? Right? So what sort of capabilities should they have? And are teams really ready today? Right. So this is something that we found from our study. So the first bit, which is the link to current and future performance. So just about 59% of leaders felt that their learning initiatives help employees fulfill their current KPIs, right? So which is what they need to do on a day-to-day basis. And about 62% felt that they encourage their employees to take up stretch projects and assignments to get them future ready. Now, again, Hari, I'm going to request you to chip in here a little bit. And I know that you're a fan of this, the second piece, which is the stretch projects and assignments, because that's where the learning really happens. Do you want to comment on this statistic here?
Yeah. So let me just comment on both the things which you mentioned in the slide, which is leaders feel that learning interventions at their organizations help fulfill current KPIs.
Yeah.
So I would say that, you know, a lot of, there are two, you know, issues here. And both these issues need to be understood well by an L&D head, which is, the first one is that a lot of leaders cannot actually articulate what their training needs are or what the training needs of the team members are. They would do that at a very high level, because it's not easy to figure out a causal relationship between a training input and business performance, because it's so difficult to find the causal link. So these guys are unable to articulate what their training needs exactly are. Therefore, they would state them at a very high level, keep them very vague. And if you also deliver at a very vague and high level, nothing gets done. Therefore, I think the first step that an L&D head or anyone in L&D needs to do is ask a series of questions to identify the real need. You need to figure out, what is this person trying to say? Even if the person is not saying it, what is the implied problem? Through a series of questions, is the problem that people need to be sent for 3 days of training, or is the problem that he's unable to find successors when somebody leaves? If the person is unable to find successors for roles, how do you deal with succession planning? Maybe that is the problem. How do you deal with succession planning? Do you need succession for every role? Do you need succession for key roles? So you should have a series of, you know, questions, and then figure out what is the problem and what, how best you can address the problem. That's when you make yourself relevant delivering on the current KPIs. Mm-hmm. As far as you know, stretch projects and assignments are concerned, I think I've already talked about it, and I think that's the best way to you know, allow people to learn. So let me just give you one example. What we've done is, Bigbasket is, we've created a very practical guide. So what we've done is, we've said that to be successful at Bigbasket, you need these six competencies. And we've defined those six competencies, identified those six. And then what we've done is we've taken each competency and identified behavioral indicators for these competencies. So for example, clarity of thought is a competency. We've identified what are the behavioral indicators, which is a person who's good at this will ask a lot of questions. A person who's good at this will cut through the smoke and noise and get to the root of an issue. A person who is good at this will be able to define a problem correctly. A person who's good at this will be able to break up a problem into its different pieces. A person who's good at this will be able to figure out, you know, that these are not important components that need to be addressed. A person who's good at this will figure out what the right assumptions to be made are, what the right approximations to be made are. Once we've defined these behavioral indicators, then we told people, if someone in your team is not displaying these behavioral indicators, obviously he or she is not good at this competency. And then we said, if someone in your team is not good at this, here are the 10 things that you can really do. Very easy things. They are not, you know, rocket science at all. And if you just customize your interaction with this particular individual who's not good at clear thinking and customize every interaction, then this guy is going to change. This person may never become outstanding, but is going to get to acceptable levels on this competency. So for example, whenever you meet this person, ask this person, so what? If the person comes and tells you, ask this person, why? If attrition has gone up, why? If succession planning isn't working, why? Anything that the person comes up to you and tells you, just ask why. This will force the person to think more clearly, get to the root. And next time onwards, when this person comes to you, will ask those 5 questions before coming to you. So if you fine tune your behaviors with this individual, that will force this individual to do things differently, then obviously this competence will get built. You can't send this person to a classroom training and say, expect it to change. I'm not totally against classroom. All I'm saying is that the 70-20 needs to be done very well. On top of that, please bolster this 70-20 with a very powerful classroom session, which will then build on this and reinforce this 90%. So the classroom training, to my mind, is about reinforcing this 90% very powerfully. Then you can get magic. Otherwise, it's not going to work. So that's my view, Subbu.
Sure, wonderful. Great, thanks, Hari. So what you're essentially saying is that, again, to summarize, is that, you know, leaders can't really articulate their learning needs very clearly. So helping them define that causal link, that's where it really starts. So they see it at a high level. So what's the problem, right? It could be succession planning or whatever it is. So identify that and then get on to problem solving. And the solution could be a classroom training, like you mentioned, but it has to be very clearly linked to that 70 and 20 that we're talking about. Great. Thanks, Ari. So moving on, of course, there is this other gap, which is what we have been talking about earlier also, which is the L&D team capability. So is the L&D team itself competent enough to understand some of these requirements of business, right? So we asked this, of course, to both HR and L&D team members, and up to 67% of respondents felt that, you know, the L&D team can anticipate future learning needs for the business. However, only about 44% felt that the L&D team can state the financial performance, for example, of their company and how it has altered over the last 3 years. And just about 40% felt that the L&D team has done a SWOT analysis of their business model. Right. So this is where the real meat of the discussion is, right? Which is, does L&D really understand the business inside and out to be able to solve those critical challenges for the business? Especially with these changes in the environment and so on and so forth. So again, question back to you, Hari. So what do you think learning managers can do to become, you know, real consultants and trusted advisors to the business?
Yeah, my view on this is that L&D professionals and even HR professionals need to understand business reasonably well. Having said that, I think it's impossible for them to understand business as well as people who do business for a living. But I think if you don't understand that reasonably well, then there would be a problem. Then you would tend to become a bit of a professor kind of an individual. Mm-hmm. Can you hear me, Subbu?
Yes.
Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, if you don't understand business at all, then you would have serious problems. Then you would become a professor, which is that you would make things very academic and come up with programs which are very academic, not necessarily having a linkage with the immediate problems at hand. And then over a period of time, you lose credibility. So my view is that while you don't have to understand business as well as those who run business, you need to have a reasonably good intuitive understanding of that. You need not understand, you know, the intricacies of a P&L statement, you know, how stock options are accounted for. All that may not be deeply necessary, but you just need to have a broad sense of, you know, this business is making money at this point of time, or this business is struggling to break even. If this business is struggling to break even, possibly these are the issues they have. These are the training requirements that they will come up to me with. So I think some understanding of business is essential, absolutely essential.
Sure. Okay, fair enough. Okay. And of course, the last section, I think, which is what we started with, which is the outcome measures. So how do you really first account for learning impact, and how do you measure it so that you can go back to business and say that, you know, this is the real impact, and without even going back, really, when business leaders themselves vouch for it or acknowledge it and also become sponsors of learning in the organization is when they see this, right? When they see this on a day-to-day basis. First of all, I think the measurement part of it itself needs a leg up. So this is what we found through our study, which is that, you know, 65% of leaders felt that they use the 70-20-10 approach, Hari, which is what you were adhering to earlier. But it's still not up there. It's 65 is still not a great number, but there are enough leaders who at least think about it and use it on a day-to-day basis. However, when it comes to Kirkpatrick's model of actually measuring your learning impact, right, only 28% said that they measure up to level 3, which is behavior, level 1 being reaction, level 2 being learning, level 3 being behavior, and only about 17% felt that they measure results, right? So do they actually see a real movement in business results as a result of the learning that they have imbibed in the organization, right? So this is the impact part of it. So again, question back to you, Hari. So if you look at these statistics, what do you think learning professionals can do to effectively measure learning impact?
Learning impact measurement, I think we'll have to be a little careful about that. So for example, the way I would look at it is that if let's say, for example, that a business unit has a problem with succession planning, then my approach to this would be map the organization structure, put the names of everyone in the respective boxes, do an assessment of these individuals, and that assessment can be done in many ways. It could be done, you know, by taking inputs from multiple people through a questionnaire, through existing performance management systems, and rate them on performance and potential. And then, you know, you can color that full org structure and figure out who are the people who are, you know, doing the current role well, but will still take time to do a bigger role, maybe yellow. Those who are brilliant, high potential, high performance, are ready to do their boss's job or one level higher job in a different part of the company, they're green. So you can just look at the color code of this org structure, which is, if you have a lot of greens, you're all set. If you have a lot of reds, you're in deep trouble. You need to do something about it. Maybe you need to get some fresh blood into this team. So I would say that it would not necessarily be numbers, but a measurement like this, how ready is this business unit in terms of overall performance and ability to get to next level? How good is this business unit head in developing talent and in maybe even releasing talent to the rest of the organization? So all that is a good indicator. So for example, I noticed that in these monthly review meetings that I talked about, some business units heads did not bring their full team. And even when they brought their team, some of their team did not speak up in those meetings. It was just the BU head or the function head who spoke up. And these were quiet individuals. So it gave us as a management team a good sense of which business is able to build leadership and which business head is not able to build leadership, where there's a weakness in the pipeline. It gave us a good sense of that. You know, who are the people who are speaking up? Who are the high potentials? So all these, you know, you can use these meetings to reinforce or, you know, to validate some of your assumptions about the readiness of an organization. So I would say measurements will have to be something like this. And I don't think you can say, you know, 10% improvement in ROI, in, you know, profitability happened, and this can be attributed to training. I can also say that, you know, some behavioral changes, you know, you can notice when after people are put through some training programs or after they're put through an intense coaching program for 3 months, you can notice, you know, some behavioral changes. But that behavioral changes, you know, is a bit subjective. And I would say that as long as you can put your hand on your heart and say, these behavioral changes have happened, I'd send this person, we put this person on coaching for better execution, and this person has is executing much better. Was a 2 on a 5-point scale, is now on a 4 on a 5-point scale. I would think that's enough, because whether 2 is earlier was subjective, 2 and 4 were subjective in some ways, but you can't go beyond this and say, you know, execution should be measured as a percentage. That doesn't work. So I think measurement is great, but you should be okay with, as long as there's a sincere attempt to do that and you're imaginative about it.
Sure. Great. Wonderful. Thanks a lot, Hari. So again, just to summarize the points that you made, Hari, so you gave again the example of succession planning and how you can, you know, draw the org chart and really find out where people are over there. And the example of monthly review meetings and how you could pick up cues from the conversations that you had in the meetings to really see what's the strength of the pipeline. And of course, you know, measuring behavioral changes, for example, that you mentioned, which are slightly more subjective, but then you can see that people are behaving and working in a different way as a result of some of these interventions, right? Great. Thanks, Hari. So what I'm going to do is I have a couple of follow-up questions for you, Hari. I'm almost through with the findings. So Hari, back to you, which is that, you know, any specific methods or tools in today's learning environment, right? Because today's learning environment is, of course, exploding. You have all kinds of tools from digital experience to platforms to classroom to blended. And, you know, so which of these do you find most useful for driving learning at Bigbasket?
So one, let me just break this up a little bit. So, for example, we have a lot of blue collar staff, and some of the blue collar staff are mobile. Some of them work in warehouses. And the processes that they work with undergo continuous change because, you know, as an e-commerce company, the logistics company, we always look at how can customer experience be better. We always look at how to make changes to process that can deliver better customer experience. So process changes means that people who are delivering those processes need to be trained. And we found that pulling them into a classroom and putting them through a refresher is not necessarily the best way of doing it. A better way of doing it would be, you know, through sending updates on their mobile. So, for example, we've got, you know, we are working with a company called Notice Board, where there is a mobile, you know, platform which people can download on their phones, and the trainer can push training modules and process updates on the mobile phone. And people are expected to go through it at the end of it, maybe even take a test. And the trainer sitting centrally, you know, in Bangalore, for example, is even able to monitor whether a person who's expected to go through this, read this and take a test in a warehouse in Pune has done it or not. So a trainer's job is now, you know, one of the trainers can actually, a training administrator can actually have a dashboard where he or she can figure out whether people who are supposed to go through this are going through this or not. So if this works well, then it'll scale. And it'll provide, you know, refreshers at a much higher level of reliability than could be provided by a face-to-face. It could be done at the learner's pace, at the learner's time, because you can't always bring people from, you know, their busy schedules into a classroom and expect them to learn. In between, there's always some idle time. Your idle time may be between 3 and 3:20, and mine may be between 5 and 5:30. So we can learn at our convenience, at our, you know, preferred timings. So some of these tools are extremely powerful. We're also using videos. So for example, after we put people through a classroom session, and if the classroom session is about problem solving, and it's a one-day program, then we will create 15 videos on this. And each video would be a bite-sized lesson, very insightful, bite-sized lesson. And that video will be interesting to watch. It will just be about 3 minutes maximum, with music in the background, with those, you know, insights coming out loud and clear. So we are finding that videos is a very good way of not just delivering first-time training, but more than that, it is about reinforcing the regular training that are done through bite-sized learning from time to time. So videos, for example, we are finding extremely powerful. So some of these are some of the tools, but my own belief is that as much as the tool, I think no tool works if the person behind the tool is not committed to making it work. So, for example, you know, there's something called EVA, Economic Value Added, which, you know, Stern Stewart, which is a consulting company, made famous in the 1990s or early 2000s.
Yeah.
It did a lot of stuff about this. But the point is that it was just old wine in new bottles. People who understood how to run their business well, people who knew, you know, that capital had a cost, and the fact that profit had to more than meet the capital cost of capital for, you know, the overall business to be seen as running well, they ran their businesses well without an EBA. EBA put a bit of a structure into this. So here my view is that if you're committed to your people, committed to having them learn, committed to, you know, upskilling them, you're imaginative about all this, then these tools will embellish that intention. They will make your approach more refined. But tools, you know, highlighting tools, making them, you know, as if they're showing that they're very cool, they're going to change people's life, I never believe that. I think tools will embellish a deeper commitment on the part of people and leaders to help their teams learn. So that's my view.
Sure. So what you're essentially saying is that don't make the means to the end itself, right? So
Yes, correct. And sometimes you see this happening. So that's what worries me sometimes.
Sure. Very interesting. Thanks for that, Hari. Great. Wonderful. I'm pretty much done with my questions, and just a quick summary of what we discussed through the study, of course, is that, you know, what's working well is that firms, of course, understand the need to align learning needs to business requirements. Inputs of key stakeholders are taken into consideration during the T&I process. And a lot of organizations have targeted learning initiatives for high potential. Right? So this is what is going well. Leadership buy-in may not always exist, and L&D teams may need to understand the needs of the business better. And the point that Hari made is that don't overdo it. You need to be reasonably good in understanding your business so that you can serve your business as well. And only a handful of organizations measure learning impact at level 4. And again, the nuanced input from Hari on this point, which is that really knowing what is it that you're measuring and only going after that and not really milking it completely dry is also very important, right? So this is a quick summary of our discussion just now. What I'm also going to do is that I'm going to request participants to type down their questions and put it on either on the chat or in the Q&A section. Feel free. And we will wait for a few minutes to have your questions and take them if you have any. Hari, anything else to add from a summary standpoint?
Nothing, Subbu.
Okay. So waiting for questions from the participants, feel free to type them down. I see a couple of them coming in. Okay. So Hari, I'm going to ask them so that you can probably take them one after the other. So Jane, of course, hi Jane, good to have you on this call. So Jane is asking Hari that, in many Asian cultures, to the example that you gave of people not speaking up in meetings, in many Asian cultures, it might be totally normal because, you know, that's just how they are culturally, they might not speak up. So does that mean that they don't have potential?
Sorry, Subbu, I missed the question. So the culturally, it may not? In some cultures?
Yeah, so how does this work across cultures is the question. In many Asian cultures, people don't really speak up in meetings, but that does not necessarily mean they don't have potential.
Yes, that's a good point, actually. So, when I was working with companies like Virtusa and Amba Research, which had, centers in places like Costa Rica, Sri Lanka, US, and different places in India, that's something that I discovered, which is that cultures are very different and you can't expect the same manifestations of culture in all the locations. So, for example, in Sri Lanka, I noticed that people were very quiet, relatively quiet. They would not express disagreement openly. And I found the same thing in Costa Rica as well. But for example, in places like India and the US, people were very happy to express themselves freely. So I think the point that Jane is making is absolutely right, which is that this varies a little across cultures. And I think you'll see that in a cultural context. So I was talking of, for example, in an Indian context where people spoke up often, and if 5 out of 6 teams were those that spoke up, expressed their views, and there was a 6th team where, you didn't find people speaking up. And also I would think leadership should be smart enough to be able to figure out whether speaking a lot is an indication of clarity or not. For example, some people might be individuals who may not speak a lot, but speak little, but demonstrate a lot of clarity in that little that they speak. So I think leadership should also be able to figure this out. So I think it's not blindly applying one standard, but it's the ability to use your intelligence on top of that. That's my view.
Sure. Great. Thanks, Hari. Okay, lots of questions coming in, Hari. I'm going to take them quickly. So the next one is on the blue collar staff. So Kanika is asking Hari, is that thanks for the insightful session. Her question is, how do you ensure high participation from your blue collar staff on micro learning and mobile learning?
So I think one way to do it is that, see, I would say that this is mandatory, which is that if some process undergoes a change, people need to be trained, because otherwise they just cannot perform the job. So in the past, when this micro learning approach using mobile technology was not there, we used to bring people into a classroom, show them a video or a short PowerPoint, put them through a test at the end of it. And if they pass the test, we assume that the refresher was done and they're competent to handle the new process. So I would say that let's start with the assumption that much of this is mandatory. So whatever is mandatory, we expect that they will go through it. They will take the test at the end of it. The trainer is there watching. If even after 3 days, a particular individual has not gone through this and has not taken the test, a reminder will go to the supervisor of this person. Why is this individual of yours not taking this test? So I would say that wherever it's mandatory, monitor, escalate, and publish. And sometimes shame a little bit, it works. But wherever something is not mandatory, I think you can try other things. You can try to gamify. You can try to give points to people who actively participate. So I think you need different approaches for different types of learnings.
Sure. Great. Wonderful. Okay. Very pointed question from Rohit Hari, which is, how do you identify a high potential?
I would say the easiest way is in your team, a high potential is someone who can do your job. So, or who comes closest to doing your job, who in some ways is able to attend meetings and solve problems that you are solving on your own, who's able to think like you, who's able to ask questions like you. So I think that's the easiest and intuitive way to identify someone who's a high potential. I mean, you can go through a complex assessment, you can do various things, but my own view is that the most intuitive way of doing it is that in your team, you always find people, who are able to think like you, who are able to address a problem like the way you would, who could do your job almost there, excepting for, some very strategic aspects of your job, excepting those that are able to do that. And some are even smart enough to do everything that you can do. So I think they are the high potentials.
Sure. Okay. Okay. Next question, Hari, is from Kalpesh Thakur, who asks, if you can share an example of measuring learning level 4 of measuring results of training effectiveness. Any such example that comes to your mind?
No, frankly, this is not a subject I really understand very well also, which is that we've not gone down this path. So I think it will not be fair for me to attempt. I don't want to bullshit. So honestly, this, I've not really done this. The final effectiveness, I've not done it.
Fair enough. Thank you. Okay. A few more questions. I'm just going through them. Rajshri is asking, do you do learning for your delivery boys channel partners? You do, right? I think that's what...
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah. What are the competencies for an L&D professional at Bigbasket? It's a good question from Narendra G.
So L&D professional, I would say, should be someone who is imaginative, can ask a lot of questions, can figure out, the linkages between business and what training can impact business performance, should be able to understand those linkages intuitively very well. We don't want somebody who brings a very academic and high level. We want people who can understand causation reasonably clearly. We want learning and development people who are practical, who can, sit across with business and push back where the requirements are not reasonable. We want people who can figure out that this training needs to be done, not through a classroom program, but by this tool. We want training people to figure out, that this is a program that's best addressed in classroom, and we won't do it in-house. We bring a specialist organization to do with this. So I think imaginative, being able to ask questions and, play brain tennis with the business folks to identify the linkages between a business problem and, a training interventions, being able to figure out when to bring an external, training capability to help with a particular problem and when to do it in-house. And I think those are some of the, I think thought leadership, we would want a training person to be a thought leader, would be wanting this person to read, would be wanting this person to be well informed on a lot of, things, should be naturally be a good reader. So somebody, for example, a journalist, you would expect that this person writes a lot, reads a lot, because without reading, you can't write. So I think while HR in some ways is a bit of more of execution, I think training requires thought leadership. So we want people who can also read and have points of view.
Sure. Wonderful. Thanks, Hari. It's very insightful. Okay. So next, a couple of more questions, Hari, after which we'll wind up, is that next question is, how does it work from a learning versus business impact specific to millennial learners? I think, again, a very specific question on millennials and the way that they learn. Have you seen any changes there?
The only point I can make about millennials is that, Subbu, I mean, this is like teaching Virat Kohli how to bat. You know, I think you understand millennials better than I do. So this is what I millennials. I think one thing I've noticed is that millennials are part of a new culture. I don't know that millennials as individuals are different, but they are in a different point of time in history where society is different. Which is that, for example, when I was young, I could never push back with my parents. Whatever my parents told me or my teacher told me, that was gospel. With my daughter, it doesn't work that way. My teacher could tell me, do this, and I would do it. With my daughter, I need to tell her why you need to do this. And if she's convinced, she'll do it. Otherwise, she won't do it. And I have to be perfectly okay with that. So I think millennials are somewhat like this, which is that they are, you know, I would say more courageous. They would not easily agree with you just because you are up higher up in the hierarchy. You will need to earn their respect. You will have to earn their respect by learning a lot from them, where you need to learn a lot from them. So learning needs to be mutual. So I think if you create that environment where you can show that you are not different, you are learning from them as much as they are learning from you. And you know, if you can explain why something needs to be done, then I think this group is just an amazing group. So I think you need to treat them with respect, openness that they deserve, and the fact that you can learn a lot from them as well. You need to, you know, accept that and demonstrate that. Then I think it works well.
Great. Wonderful. Okay. Next question from Deepthi Hari. Again, a very interesting question, which is on how do you help move employees from classroom to online or self-paced learning? And how can she successfully implement this? Any thoughts on that?
Let me understand the question, which is how do you move people from classroom training to online?
To online or self-paced, wherein they learn on their mobile, etc. How do you make that shift?
Let me just step back a little and talk about a broader problem, which is that if a problem exists, if a problem is serious, then I think an individual is receptive to a solution. An individual is receptive to a solution only if there is a serious problem. So for example, if classroom training is a problem, then the individual is receptive to alternate methods of learning. If classroom training, for example, is not a problem, then they would not be receptive. So let's just take the different stakeholders. Let's take management, for example. Let's take a company like IBM. They were spending millions of dollars actually moving people from different parts of the company to classrooms in different parts of the world and putting people through expensive training programs. The cost of travel and the cost of hotel stay was very high. At some point, they just couldn't take it. So it was a serious problem. So management immediately bought the concept of how can we do online training? How can we make online training effective? How can we make webinars effective? How can we make other forms of online training effective? So because there was a problem, they were very open to an answer. So I think, first of all, if that problem exists, then I think people will easily migrate. And I think people should feel excited to participate in online programs. I think one of the things in an offline program is that you get to meet people. At the end of it, it's not just the instructor who's talking. You get to interact between sessions, during the session, with your co-participants. And that's as much of a learning as it is from the trainer. So I think discussions are very critical for learning. So if you can simulate some of the, you know, environment of a classroom, which is ability to have good discussions between different participants, create that energy level, have some gamification, then I think it's going to work. So you need to do some of that to create that excitement.
Okay, great. So there are two parts to that answer that you gave, Hari, which is very interesting for me to hear. One is the trigger, right? What's really the trigger to move, and is it strong enough for the organization to move in that direction? And therefore, once you move, how do you really get people excited to adopt to that shift is the point that you were making.
Yes.
Yeah. Great. Wonderful. Okay. More questions coming in, Hari. I think there are three more. Shall we quickly take them?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. So how do you rate the success rate of MOOCs in organization? I know that you have done MOOCs in Bigbasket also. This is from Narendra Ji. So how do you rate the success of MOOCs in an organization? Can the participants get, that's second part is for me. So the question, Hari, is how do you rate the success of MOOC?
At Bigbasket, frankly, it has not been very successful. We have not been able to drive it very successfully. But if you ask me, I think the potential for MOOCs is amazing. So I'll tell you what, ultimately, learning, whose responsibility it is to learn. I think if you say that the organization is responsible for the learning of their people, then we've got it completely wrong. I think it is the individual who is responsible for his or her learning. In today's world, if you are not continuously learning, and I think in any world, even in the past world, but today it's more so, if you're not continuously learning, you become irrelevant quickly. It is yours and only your responsibility to learn. So MOOCs is a great tool to help you learn at your pace, at your free time, and pick topics of your choice. So I think MOOCs works very well for people who are deeply committed to learning and for people who are internally driven. If the organization needs to force people to learn, I don't think MOOCs is going to work. MOOCs is all these tools, you know, are available. It all depends on how you want to use it as an individual. So I think MOOCs works really well for those who want to learn. For those who don't care to learn, no point. It'll never work. Nothing works.
Sure. Great. I think one point to add there, Hari, is from our own experience, what we've seen is that if you just leave it open, if you leave the entire universe of learning open to employees, people generally drift towards areas that are easy to learn or that are exciting to learn may or may not add value to the work that they're doing. So that's something that we've seen. For example, we heard that a large bank that adopted MOOCs in India, the top, the most subscribed course was baking, right? Mm-hmm. Which is great. I mean, which is great to learn, great for engagement. But here we're talking about learning outcomes and ROI. It completely defeats that purpose. So how do you really curate that entire MOOC universe to be able to, have that excitement at the same time, ensure that it's in line with the business requirements also.
Yeah, true.
Okay, great. Do you think this question, next question, Hari, is from Anushree. Anushree Jog, she asks, do you think gamification works in learning and training?
Yeah, so these are all, I'm not a great fan of some of these new approaches. Maybe I am conventional and, old school, you can argue. So I think all of these are, attempts to get people who are inherently not learning to learn. So I think to that extent, they're partially successful and effective. That means some people who have a resistance or a block to learning, if you can create this gamification, make it interesting. And in the process, if they learn, then I think gamification is amazing. But at some point of time, if gamification becomes the end, then I think we have a problem. So all of these, I think, are just amazing tools to be able to help people who are otherwise not very open to learning. So for example, induction, right? When an employee is made an offer, we provide a lot of our policies and many things and some of our PowerPoints about the business available to people, even before he or she joins the company. And hopefully we are expecting that before joining the company, they go through all the policies, they go through how our business is run, how we make money, how we operate, what's our culture. But it doesn't work always. So there is some kind of a gamification which gives them points, which gives them incentives. At the end of it, their scores are published. So to that extent, it works a little bit, but I think deeply, that's my view. Yeah.
Sure. Thanks, Hari. Also to add, Hari, since we work in the areas of gamification, Anushree, maybe I can also add to that point that Hari made, which is that one learning that we've had is that the design of, how you use those points, badges and leaderboards becomes very critical. So like Hari mentioned, if it's an end in itself, then it's not going to help the process. But if it's helping in the engagement, the way that the game itself has been designed, and if it's also speaking to the intelligence of the learner, if the learner sees value that, wow, this is exciting for me. Otherwise, if it is seen as something that's trivial, that's, like another Farmville or something that you're playing on Facebook, these serious learners who really want to learn in today's environment, and this includes millennials, they feel disengaged. So that the design component becomes extremely key. The way that you go to learner with these kind of interventions. So that's just something to add to what Hari was saying. Okay. Hari, next question. I think these are the last couple of questions, Hari. Next one is from Sarvesh Kumar. He's asking, to this point of training effectiveness, so how can we make training effectiveness rating more easy and interesting for the concerned HOD?
Training effectiveness rating, this is again not a topic that I really understand because I've spent a lot of time on this. So I'll tell you where we have stopped, which is if there was a problem that someone came to us, an HOD came to us with a problem, diagnosed the problem, we figured out what is the intervention that was required and what is the expectation or outcomes that we've expected from the interventions, figured out at the end of 3 months or 2 months or 1 month, whatever, where some of those outcomes met and to what extent they were met. And these we would share. So that's broadly what I would say we would do for every, you know, reasonably big requirement that the HOD comes to us with. We would do this. Just go through a diagnosis properly, identify mutually what is the training or what is the intervention, may not even be a training intervention. What's the intervention? Figure out whether the intervention worked or not based on outcomes that we defined earlier, and then go back and show those.
Sure. Okay. Great. Wonderful. I think the last question now is from Kapila Sebastian Hari, which is an organization that has a strong appetite for experiential and disruptive learning. Could you share an example of effectiveness measurement for such an experience? Any thoughts here?
What is example of disruptive learning?
Yeah, experiential learning. This is more in line with what KNOLSKAPE does. So I can also take this if you want.
Yeah, you take it. Why don't you take it?
Sure. So I'll do that. So Kapila, plenty of examples of effectiveness measurement for experiential learning, because that's what we do at KNOLSKAPE as an organization. To give you an example, if you were to take these three, the same four levels of Kirkpatrick that we've been talking about, right? So level one, feedback is very clear. So the way that we run experiential programs is that typically these are blended with classroom sessions, could be for a few hours, and you have technology which is enabling that learning there. So the level one is the feedback, right, which is from the participants who underwent that. So that's clear. Level two, the learning. Again, there are different ways in which you can test the learning or the awareness after they have been through such a program. So we have another tool called Active Quiz, through which we run quizzing sessions across the organization to see what is the level of awareness of these individuals who have taken this particular program. Level three, of course, is behavior. So we do a 360 degree pre and post measurement for some of our leadership journeys, right? These are 6 month leadership journeys. They go through these kind of programs for 6 months. So we do a pre and a post to find out what's the shift in the movement or the needle movement in behavior. These could be manager feedback, participant feedback, or a 360 degree feedback, right? And level four is ROI. So if there are action learning projects which are tied back into some of these experiential learning assignments, then those also get measured. So if there are projects that learners have taken up during the course of these journeys, we see what's again the needle movement. Have these projects been successful? What's the process they have adopted? What's the progress, etc.? So on and so forth. So there are ways in which you can measure across each of these four levels. So that's just to give you an example of how we do it. Right. So that's about it from our end. Hari, thanks a lot for coming in. I will just take a quick minute. I have the last couple of slides. So this is what we do as an organization. Thank you everybody for logging in. If ever you have needs across any of these points, feel free to reach out to us. We are in four countries as of now, but we deliver across 22 countries across the world. And these are our coordinates. So if you want to participate in the study that I just showed you, you can type this URL on your screen and you can take the study for yourself. It'll just take 10 minutes. It'll also help us gain further data points for our research. And if you want to reach out to any of us, either to Hari or to me, our email addresses are also on the screen. So thanks a lot, everybody, for logging in. And once again, special thanks to you, Hari, for taking the time out and lots of questions. I hope you enjoyed the session.
Thoroughly enjoyed it, Subhut, and thanks for having me.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. And look forward to engaging with you more. And all of the other participants also, please do join in our regular webinars. We host these every month. Thank you. Thanks.
Thanks.
Yeah.